Hip and groin issues can be very prevalent in sport, especially those that involve rapid changes of direction or perhaps kicking. Interestingly, these issues often occur with a gradual onset. So testing and tracking the strength in the hip and groin area may be a useful monitoring tool for us. There are a number of different tools available to us. We might use a sphygmomanometer, which is a pressure cuff that allows us to measure the adductor squeeze. Or there's dynamometry, whether that is isokinetic dynamometer or handheld dynos, which allow you to measure the force conducted in the limbs during eccentric, concentric, and isometric movements. And in recent times, technology has developed to incorporate load cell assessments, so we can collect force measurements during isometric contraction in many different positions. And today, we're going to focus on measuring isometric adductor and abductor strength using VALD Performance ForceFrame. So the force frame enables a whole host of testing positions to be used. And in this video, I'm going to focus on what is probably the most common, and that is adductor-adductor testing in a supine position with a bent knee. So you have the athlete lie down, and then you need to decide on the knee position that you want to use for your testing. So commonly used angles are 45 degrees, 60 degrees, or 90 degrees. The most important thing is that you are consistent. You may choose to measure a couple of these, but whatever you do, you want to log it in the system and use that position consistently across your testing so you can compare. So the first time testing with an athlete, you want to use a goniometer to make sure you get the correct knee angle that you've chosen. And that will then determine the bar height as well as the athlete's foot position. And thereafter, by logging this bar height, either in the system if it allows it, or somewhere on your computer or pen and paper, you can then automatically set for that athlete their bar height, and you don't necessarily need to use the goniometer and formally measure the angle each time. You're aiming for the athlete to be able to constantly push out on those knee pads or squeeze in on them. So you want the femoral condyles of the knee to be placed centrally within those pads. Now, personally, I like to instruct athletes to keep their arms crossed over their chest so they're not tempted to push down on the ground. And also, another instruction really important for this test is to tell the athlete to keep their butt down because they may want to lift off the ground and leverage to create more force. But obviously, we want to keep that consistent. In terms of a warm-up, as well as having done a standardized warm-up, I like to then use a 50% effort rep followed by a 75% effort rep before getting into the maximum trials. And for the test itself, you have the athlete conduct 5 second long reps, alternating between squeezing in and then pulling out with the abductors. And then leave about 30 seconds or so in between each set of abductor and adductor reps. And if you can, do 3 lots of these trials. Now, it's very normal for athletes to feel a pop during an adductor squeeze. This is very common and natural. It is just pressure being released from the joint due to the squeeze. And another tip I have for the testing protocol on the adductor-abductor test is to track pain. Pain can be a really important indicator in hip and groin issues, so it is worth asking them about their pain. And you might use either a yes or no response, or you might want to track it with a numerical pain scale between 0 and 10. As for results from this test, it provides us with 4 key outcomes: abductor isometric strength in terms of force output on the left and right, and adductor force output on the left and right. So our starting point is to look at our absolute force capacities of our players in these tests, and we can compare them to themselves over time. And we also can compare them, obviously, to the rest of their team, but also their playing position. And depending on the sport you're working with, between position differences can be quite noticeable. So for instance, goalkeepers, given their different demands, can be very different profiles in this test to outfield players. And similarly, in the NFL, which I've spoken about before in terms of having a real wide variety in playing position demands, we see very different profiles for the long snapper and the lineman, for instance, who have very specific demands compared to other players on the team. Thank you to VALD Performance for sponsoring this video. Combining advanced sensors with real-time results and analytics, the Force Frame is the most versatile and portable system for testing muscle strength and imbalance, as well as for prescribing and performing isometric training. To contact VALD or to book a demo, check out their website, valdperformance.com. So then with these 4 results, we can look at between limb imbalances as well as within limb imbalances. So firstly, looking at between limbs, so left and right side imbalances in either adductors or abductors. You want to understand what asymmetry calculation the system is putting out, or maybe you have a preference because there are lots of different ways that we can calculate differences between left and right sides. And of course, we are not necessarily looking for perfect balance, particularly in sports that involve kicking. Most of these sports have asymmetrical demands, so it is normal to see differences between the left and the right sides in our athletes. So this is why it's so important to track individual data over time and compare them to themselves. And you might also want to log the kicking side, the dominant side, in your data set so that you can incorporate that into your analysis. So as well as looking between limbs, we also want to look within limbs in this hip and groin test. The adduct-abductor ratio is very well researched. So the system probably calculate this ratio for you, but if you're looking to do it manually, it is adductor divided by abductor force output on the same side. You get a left-sided adductor-abductor ratio and a right-sided adductor-abductor ratio. So obviously a ratio of one would show that you're producing the same force output in this test in the adductors and the abductors. And the further away either side you get from one, the greater imbalance that you have. And much of the early work in this ratio came from ice hockey, and specifically Tim Tyler. And his early study in 2001 showed prospectively that the ratio of athletes in this NHL team who went on to be uninjured in the hip and groin region in the season was 0.95. Compared that to the players who went on to get injured, and they had a much lower ratio of 0.78. So based on this work, it was suggested that in athletes, or at least in this case in ice hockey athletes, aiming for a ratio of at least 0.8 was recommended. But of course, we don't want to go too far the other way as well and become overly imbalanced in the other direction. So often in ice hockey, this ratio 0.8 to 1.2 is identified and targeted. But of course, we have to be careful when applying benchmarks to different groups, different sports, and as I've already mentioned, different playing positions. It depends on the demands of your sport and your role. So it makes sense that we'd be striving for a fairly balanced strength capacity in this region, and we can assess that using this ratio. But again, be careful of translating ratios and benchmarks from other sports or playing positions or populations. Test this in your playing group and look at their norms and their baseline data. So limitations to this test, again, we are only looking at isometric capacities in a very limited position. And in particular, the hip and groin area is complicated, and there are many different structures of which they are overlapping. And so we are looking at a very simple fixed demand here. This is a static test, so it doesn't capture an athlete's biomechanics, which actually in this area can be an important diagnostic tool for issues. But like I've spoken about on other isometric tests in this series, this test provides a very simple, safe, and non-fatiguing approach whereby we can collect data on the strength of our athletes. And it has the added benefit that this can be incorporated as a training is testing approach, or otherwise known as invisible monitoring, as I've discussed before, because if athletes are already doing isometrics in their training program, then potentially capturing this regularly is not going to involve additional testing. Hope you enjoyed this video, and please keep a lookout for the next video in our strength testing series sponsored by VALD Performance coming very soon.